world of plants and trees. Source of life for all the Earth's inhabitants. Rich in the promise of abundance, yet dependent on two things, sun and soil. The subsoil, and above it the skin of topsoil. Seemingly lifeless, yet within it the penetrating eye discovers a hidden world. Here are the ultimate particles of soil. Rock coated with organic humus, separated by pockets of air and water. Within live the soil's smallest inhabitants, the bacteria, so tiny that in a teaspoonful of soil, they outnumber the population of the Earth. Among them, the nitrogen-fixing bacteria, organisms able to convert the nitrogen of the air into chemicals needed for plant life. Their food, the ever-branching fungi, forming a mass of living tissue in the soil. Feeding on these bacteria and holding them in check are countless larger microscopic creatures. Larger again, the enchytrades, minute worms. Springtails, wingless insects, little changed in 300 million years. Above ground, the snail forages for its food, but returns to a fixed home in the soil. And there, the earthworm tunnels its way, passing the soil through its body, and so helping to aerate and fertilize it. Big and small, these creatures are in balance with one another, eating, fighting, dying, being born, in numbers beyond human comprehension. With the growth of intensive farming, man has upset this balance. For in the crop roots which shoot everywhere down into the soil, he has provided a rich diet for a host of pests. Among the most destructive of soil pests is the cabbage root fly, whose larvae inflict wounds which damage the roots as well as exposing them to disease. Result? Crop loss of cabbage, cauliflower, turnip, and other plants of the brassica family. Wireworms, tough-skinned and agile, bore through the soil, chewing off small roots as they go, tunneling into large ones. Thus they live for 3 to 5 years in the top 6 inches of the soil. Result? Widespread damage to root crops, cereals, vegetables, flowers. Where the crop is not completely destroyed, it is often so damaged as to be almost valueless. Cutworms, like most soil pests, are larval forms of insects which live above ground. Their various species attack almost every kind of crop, though the adult moth is harmless. Here, more than half a potato crop has been destroyed. The cutworms have eaten the plants just above ground level and have dragged parts of them back into their burrows. White grubs are among the most voracious of all these pests. They stay underground for 3 years or more, chewing away whole root systems before emerging as adult cockchafers. Result? Here, an entire potato crop destroyed. Cereals, nursery stock, in fact, most cultivated crops are attacked by the white grub. On a badly infested field, most of the plants are dead or dying. In the tropics, the banana weevil passes its whole life in the rootstock as larva, pupa, and adult beetle. Result? With the root system destroyed, the plant sickens and the fruit dies. Until recent times, farmers and agronomists were mystified by an unseen pest which stunted growth and thus reduced yield. The magnifier sometimes showed tiny cysts clinging to the root. Only beneath the microscope was the culprit revealed, the eelworm, a nematode of which more than 100 species scattered all over the world are parasitic and destructive to plant life. Their mouths contain a sharp spear, which they can shoot out to pierce the tender roots of plants. Result? Abnormal growth and distortion of the root system of many crops. Secondary infections borne by bacteria, viruses, and molds. In the United States alone, damage estimated at $400 million a year. Here in Venezuela, a colony of leaf-cutting ants has attacked a citrus tree. Within a few hours, they will have stripped it of every leaf. Soldier ants carving the leaves with their formidable jaws, the workers carrying loads many times their own weight, combine in a task force, thousands strong, to drag the foliage back to their nest. The leaves are chewed up by the worker ants, and on them a tasty fungus is grown. This fungus garden feeds the whole colony, and at its head, the queen, who may live for a decade and mother countless millions of ants. The nests, interconnected by underground tunnels, may spread across an acre or more of fertile ground, denying it to human cultivation. Most of the life beneath the soil is beneficial to man. What is harmful can only be attacked on the basis of a sure knowledge. Here on the famous Broadbalk field at Rothamsted, studies in soil science begun a century ago are still in progress. Samples of young wheat plants are being collected and examined in the laboratory. By dissection of the plant, a count is made of the larvae of the wheat bulb fly, which may do more than £1 million of damage a year in England alone. From the sample, an aggregate figure is calculated. 500,000 larvae per acre. For different insects, different methods of sampling. This soil core contains wireworms. The samples, several to the acre, are placed in trays. The trays are heated, and the wireworms, struggling to escape, rise to the surface where they are easily counted. Two wireworms per core sample indicate 1 million wireworms per acre. Yet after more than a century of study, our knowledge of the soil is far from complete. Visit the world's agricultural centers and you will find the scientist investigating not only the pests, but the entire fauna of the soil. You may discover him in Darwin's footsteps, tracking the earthworm to its burrow. For there is still much to learn about what it eats and where it breeds. He may have to rear some insects in controlled conditions so as to have enough of them for his experiments. Or you may find him setting up a tank of hot water linked by a copper bar to a tank of ice, making a temperature gradient between hot and cold. On this bar, he is placing mites to see where they gather in greatest numbers. For they will move to the place where they are most comfortable and thus tell him what soil temperatures they like best. Without accurate knowledge of the life cycle of pests, their effective control is impossible. Even the commonest of soil pests may have to be kept under observation. It is mid-May, and the pupae of the cabbage root fly lie buried in the soil. The previous winter's severity will determine just when they emerge as flies, so they are observed from day to day in the laboratory. The flies are harmless to the crop, but the appearance of the eggs on plant or ground must be watched for. A week or so later, the larvae will hatch out and start to feed on the roots. It is then that they must be attacked. Otherwise, above ground, the damaged plants wilt and die. It's very important to time the attack on soil pests exactly. Here in Holland, agronomists keep watch for the appearance of eggs, in readiness to alert farmers through the national broadcasting system.
Dat is denk ik wel tijd om een radio.
Anke, koolvliegeieren zijn gevonden in huizen. Wil je het op de kaart aangeven?
De plantenziektekundige dienst deelt mee dat in het zuiden en zuidwesten van het land de eerste koolvliegen zijn verschenen en de eerste eiafzetting is geconstateerd.
The traditional answer to an outbreak of soil pest was to change to a new crop or allow a field to remain fallow. Then, after a few years, plant the old crop again. Today, crop rotation is still an accepted method of combating soil pests. Certain pests, which lie not too deep in the soil, are destroyed by the normal tools of cultivation. Sometimes special tractor attachments are used against white grubs, which are mutilated by the blades, or die from exposure to the hot sun. But the most effective method of killing soil pests on a large scale is to use chemicals to penetrate into the soil. The search for new chemicals is going forward all over the world. Each new compound is thoroughly tested in advance to make sure that it has no ill effect on plant growth. The aim? To give the farmer even more efficient and economical means of control. When the research and testing are done, another team of experts comes into play to spread the knowledge of how chemicals can best be applied. It takes only the simplest equipment for the Venezuelan farmer to rid his fields of the once triumphant colonies of ants. poison acts swiftly on skin and stomach alike. Death of the queen, the life source of the whole colony has been destroyed. Insecticides may be applied in many different ways, depending on the crop that needs protection. Diluted with water, they may be delivered in sprays, as here around cabbage seedlings. Here, against the banana weevil. Dusted onto strawberry plants with a portable two-stroke motor. Applied with sand onto cabbages. Mixed with bran against cutworms. And increasingly, coated on the seeds themselves, putting the insecticides where they are needed most. Against the microscopic nematodes, highly effective fumigants can be injected. On larger farms, these pesticides, whether fumigants or sprays, can be applied by multiple nozzle tractor-drawn equipment. At last, the soil pests are beginning to yield to scientific attack. Across the world, the bare, stunted acres can be transformed into rich harvests. Yet today, one quarter of all the world's foodstuffs is lost to plant pests and diseases. Enough to make good the diet of the two-thirds of mankind still underfed. Each year that the crops are gathered in, the world has 35 million more mouths to feed. By the century's end, its population may be doubled. This is the challenge to the farmer, and to all whose concern is the living soil.